ladies and gentlemen, the Doobie Brothers.
Girl, where you gonna hide? got together in San Jose, California, in 1969, late 69, early 1970. I myself and a friend of mine who played bass went to San Jose to make it big and famous. And we got a rude awakening. We starved for a while. We got together with a guy named Tom Johnston and played a lot of clubs around San Jose for $5 a night. We worked once a week for about a year or so, maybe less. And we got a break with a production company in San Mateo who put us on our first album on Warner Brothers. At that time, we were called PUD, and it was one morning that a friend of ours who was eating breakfast with us at the table said, "You guys are looking for a name," and we had been for a few weeks previous. "You guys ought to call yourselves the Doobie Brothers." Ha ha. It was ridiculous. It sounded hokey, first off, and we needed something else, so we decided to use it. We kept it, and here we are today. Since the band's been together, there have been a number of musical changes. We first started the band as a power trio, bass, drums, and guitar. Then we incorporated three horn players into the group, still as a power bass trio with horns. Later on, they dropped out, and we got another guitar player, which was Pat Simmons.
We had the world's biggest amplifiers when we first went on the road. Each one of us had about 400 or 500 watts that we were working with, and blowing the audience away. They liked it, you know. In those days, early 70s, it was okay to play that loud. People have begun to realize that it hurts. We've sort of changed with each album that we put out. Our first album was mainly kind of an acoustic type album. A lot of acoustic guitars and almost country type songs. The second album we got into more of a blues rock and roll vein. Third album is probably a little more Latin and a little more production in the studio, I think. The fourth album is like real R&B, What Were Once Spices was a real rhythm and blues type album. Stampede sort of went to, we did a little bit of country rock and roll, then with Taking It to the Streets we again were into an R&B, a little more of a jazz kind of a thing, and then with Living on the Fault Line we have continued, I think, in the rhythm and blues direction, but maybe have become a little more sophisticated musically on this album. And then the next one coming up after this is back to the roots again. I think we'll probably be a little more rock and roll oriented album. So we're going round and round.
Feeling that I have that I'm going to write something about usually takes its form in a certain form of music. It could be rock, it could be jazz, it could be R&B or semi-classical. Whatever strikes the mood of the song is the way I write. It's real fun to be out and play for people and, you know, just really get off on playing and stuff. But if I had my druthers, I'd beam myself home every night. Boop! Because I'm basically a homebody at heart, and I'd rather be playing around a familiar area where I could just relax. I find it very hard to relax on the road. I can't write on the road. Can't really, you know, fit myself into it that much. So I'm sort of nervous and keep to myself a lot. The whole experience of road life is very peculiar, and it's exciting. It's boring. It's about every emotion you could possibly name. It goes through the entire spectrum. But one thing it isn't is it's not extremely dull.
It's boring and thrilling all at the same time. You're out there on those plane rides and those sometimes bad meals and lousy beds and long nights sometimes, long hours, under a lot of pressure most of the time. Just for that 2 hours, hour and a half to 2 hours that we get on stage and play. And it's worth it for that. Yeah, all the bad things are worth doing just for that time.
I know you're leaving,
Well, before I got into the Doobie Brothers, I played in this band called Steely Dan. And then before that, I played in Linda Ronstadt's band. And before that, I played in Buzzy Linhart's band. And before that, I played in Carly Simon's band. And then before that, I played in the Holy Modal Rounders. And then before that, I played in the Ultimate Spinach. And then before that was a very dark time in Mexico.
When I joined the Doobie Brothers, they were going through a transitional period. Tommy Johnston was not taking as big a role in the band as he had been before. Other members of the band were starting to really kind of blossom as songwriters and, you know, players. And when I came into the band, it seemed to me like a lot of the guys in the band were looking for something new. All of a sudden, everybody started writing great songs. Not me, I don't write songs, but very many. But the other guys in the band started writing these really great songs with all these nice changes. And everybody started getting off more and more, and Michael came into the band, and his keyboard, the addition of a piano or a keyboard instrument in a band that was all guitars, added the one harmonic piece that was missing.
It wasn't until I started writing for the band that I really felt like I had a place in the band. It was hard to, I think with this band, to come up with piano parts, quite honestly, for a band that was so basically a guitar band, you know. There wasn't a lot of space left for a piano, for keyboards, you know. Over the years, I just had worked without one that they pretty much, you know, covered up any real need for one. It was, we had to do a lot of rearranging of songs to make it work.
I worked for the band as a stage manager and settled the box office and stuff like that, and played too. I asked them if I could just play in the band at one point, you know, that I wanted to be a sideman. And they all said, yeah, okay.